So to create a new process at the user level, we would call the fork syscall. So this creates a new process and initializes a new entry in all of the kernel data structures that are needed in order to maintain processes. To user code, however, the function call, the fork function call, appears to return twice. This is something that you may have not seen before in programming. And that's why it's called fork, because you can think of it as sort of a fork in the road, right? This is quite bizarre if you've never seen this before. But basically, the program executes up to that point, and then it splits into two processes. One process continues sort of the original process, and then there's also the child process that returns there as well. So the fork system call will return a different value, and this is how you can determine in code after the fork whether or not you're in the child process or you're in the parent process. So if the function returns zero, then it's in the child process, and if it returns a non-zero number, then you know that it's the parent process, and the number that it actually returns is going to be the process ID of the child, which the parent can use to monitor that process if it wishes. But both processes will continue to execute concurrently, and that's the important part. They will have separate address spaces at this point, so the child's address space is going to be a duplicate of the parent's address space at the time of the fork, so everything in the parent's address space gets copied into the child's address space, but then they will diverge, so they are not links to each other, they are completely separate address spaces, and things that were duplicated before will begin to diverge. So if the child changes a value of a variable, for instance, then the parent will not be able to see it. However, there is some amount of data that's shared between the parent and child. The child will inherit the environment any open files, but again, these are going to be shared resources, and we'll talk a little bit more about how files are shared next time. These things may begin to diverge after the child has run for a while separately from the parent. Okay, so here's a code example. So here we're calling fork, and so it's worth thinking for a second about what this will output. So if you run this code, you'll see that it prints before fork once, and then it prints after fork twice. And one of them will print zero, pid equals zero, that of course is the child process, right? And then one of the processes will print after fork, and then we'll have a number. And we know that's the parent process, and we know that the number that it's printing is the process ID of the child. So it's worth pausing the video for a minute and thinking about what this code will do, and you might actually want to type this in on Stu and run it. So take a second and think about what you think this code snippet is going to do. Okay, so this code calls fork twice. So the observation here is that fork returns twice every time. And so the first fork is going to create an extra process, the new child process. But then when we get to the second fork, both the child and the parent of the original fork are going to run the second fork. And so we're going to get a total of four processes at the end rather than three. So it's worth thinking through this and thinking about what the output will be at each of these steps. So after the second fork, we're going to see various combinations of these numbers, and it's worth thinking through what those are, and then you can try this example on Stu to confirm your suspicions. So it'd be a good example exercise here as well to see how would you modify this program in order to fork a total of three processes at the end. So two additional processes rather than four. You'd have to insert a special check to ensure that one of the processes that come out of the original fork does not execute the second fork, because otherwise you'd get the four processes that we can see in the diagram here. The parents can also wait for the children to finish, because, as you remember, the fork function returns the process ID of the child in the parent process. So here's an example of the parent waiting for the child. Here we're just waiting for any child, so we don't actually need the PID, but if we had a parent that had created a bunch of different children, it could choose which one to wait on. And these are the system calls that are provided for parents and children to manage processes. So you need to include a couple of files. There's a new type called PID T, which is a PID value. And then there are a variety of system calls that create processes, that return process IDs, that terminate processes, that load other programs, which we'll talk a little bit more about in the next video, sleeping processes to suspend them, or waiting for other processes to terminate. And so we won't talk in too much detail about these, but you'll need a couple of them for the lab, and so it's worth looking at the documentation to determine what these functions do.